Figma has released their Glass Effect as a native feature within Figma. The best news is they have been working together with Apple. We have access in the Figma community today to the iOS and iPadOS 26 library that contains that liquid glass effect. And in this video, I'm going to show you the Figma Glass Effect on its own, leveraging the playground file that Figma just created so that you also can utilize it and explore how to use this effect. But I'm also going to show you the iOS library added as a UI kit that you can simply add the way we use the other UI kits. All those links are available in my video description below, so make sure to check them out so you can follow along. But we're going to explore all this, what it means for you, especially if you are an iOS designer. This is fantastic. So the first file that we're going to explore is the Figma Glass Effect Playground. It shows you that the Figma Glass Effect is still in beta mode. And of course, they're doing many iterations for it, but I think the reason they had to launch it so fast is so that Apple can release their iOS library, which everybody has been waiting for, the iOS 26. To see the glass effect, always remember this, you need a background behind it. This component that looks like an iOS tab bar or an iOS action menu. If you go to effects right here, if you add an effect in your dropdown, now you have glass as an available option to you. And once you've selected it, you have the option to manipulate so many features like the light. Where is the light coming from? At what degree? At what angle? You can manipulate this icon either by moving it around, which changes the value. And that is the angle where the light is being reflected. Do you see how the little white gradient is changing based on the position of the light? If I click it and drag it, simply I will be able to move to any number that I want. But if I want it to move in increments of 45 degrees, if I click shift and drag, then I'm moving in these angles of 45 degrees, just increasing by 45 degrees each time. This is a percentage of the light so that you can either increase the intensity or reduce it. We're going to look at all these different settings in detail just to understand the differentiation between them, even though, truthfully, the only way you will get to understand the nuances of all this is if you were to play around with it. But I will give you a very quick explanation to get you started. Refraction controls what happens with the background behind this lens. The more you increase the refraction, the more the background will get distorted behind this glass lens. So if I were to reduce the refraction to zero, you will see if I move the glass, nothing happens behind it. The more I increase it, the more distortion happens to the background. Maybe distortion is not the right word. It's just how much the background is impacted and affected by the glass lens. Depth decides how deep or is how thick, like in actuality, is your glass looking. So if we increase that, it makes this lens look so much thicker. It makes the glass thicker, and of course, it affects the refraction as well. Now with this lens selected, you will see when my refraction is high, the background is really reacting to my lens. Same thing when the depth is high. Now, dispersion adds a little bit of color to the lens. If we play with the dispersion and the depth together, you will see some kind of color gets added to this component. If we remove dispersion, this will go back to black and white, but adding the dispersion will give it some kind of a color. The last setting to highlight is the frost, and I'm really excited about this setting because it actually allows for realistic use of the glass feature, the glass effect. If you increase the frost, it's kind of increasing the blur and the opacity on this layer. So in a way, It reduces the interaction with the background, but at the same time, it makes the content a bit more accessible because it's contrasting a little more with the background. So Frost is super useful, especially if you have a menu or a navigation that you want to stick out from the background. But the more you increase it, of course, then the less you have interaction with the background. So these are all the different settings that you can find in the gloss effect in Figma. This file is a wonderful asset for you to explore and have fun with it and just create different things. It has a lot of inspirations on how you can use the glass. But of course, it's a trial and error. Few things that are worthwhile to note. The glass is available inside a prototype, which is really useful. So I'm going to click Shift Spacebar just to demo this. It's at the very bottom of the screen. This glass effect that is applied right here on this toolbar in this music app is actually interacting with the background. So this is super nice and useful if you wanted to mimic the functionality of the liquid glass that exists in the iOS app. Yay! They're finally working together. Congratulations, Apple team, Apple designers. I'm so proud of you. Definitely iOS and iPadOS 26 UI kit is much better. It's a huge improvement from all the previous UI kits that we've had before. To be fair, we've only had iPadOS and iOS 18. How do you leverage the iPadOS 26? If you were to come here to your assets in any file that you are using, if you were to create a new file, any new design file, and you go to your assets, click on libraries, UI kits, you will see iOS and iPadOS 26 UI kit has finally become available to us. So coming here, I will click add to file. And now let's see what's available to us in this library. You have action sheets, you have examples, activities, alerts, all the different components that you may want to use, lists, page controls. I'm going to click F on my canvas for a frame. I will add an iPhone 16. Let's use a tab bar from our iOS UI kit. There's a tab bar for iPhone and one for iPad. Let's use the iPhone one. You can resize it to the frame. Okay, great, it's responsive. Now, I want to put on my frame an image just so that we're able to see the liquid glass effect. I've copied this image and I'm going to paste it on my frame. So now I will bring back my tab bar and here it is. Let's resize this tab bar, but you can see the moment we've put it on a background that is not just plain black or white, you can see the glass effect, the liquid glass effect. Now, let's go to the actual component and inspect it a little bit to see how Apple have used the Figma glass effect. If you come here to this background and you open it, you have to dig a little deeper. If you open it, you will see there's a locked layer called Glass Effect. And when you click on it, now we see the settings that Apple have applied to their library. You have a refraction of 60, depth of 30, dispersion, and frost. It's really nice to see the Apple default for the liquid glass in action. If we wanted to manipulate the instance of this component, you can see this is an instance of the tab bar. With the main component selected, you can have a separate search. Wow, that's amazing. You can create the number, select the number of tabs that you want. And of course, I expect that if you use SF symbols, you'll be able to replace them the same way we've used the previous UI kits. If you haven't seen this before, SF Symbols is an application that you download from the Apple Store. I have a full detailed tutorial that shows you how to download SF Pro and SF Symbols to be able to work with the UI kits that are released by Apple. So if you open SF Symbols, you can come here and search for any icon that you may need. So let's say I want home. Okay, here's the home icon. The best way to select this is you right click, copy the symbol. You can come to the right property panel, select the symbol and click Command V, And as you can see, once I hit enter, now my icon is changed and reflected. So to change the text, you need to have SF Pro downloaded. If you don't have SF Pro downloaded to your Mac, you will not be able to utilize this. And in my previous tutorial, I had a lot of questions from people who are using PCs or just Microsoft or different laptops that are not Macs. And unfortunately, they were not able to customize or utilize the iOS UI kit fully. So hopefully they're finding a solution for this. But when it comes to the liquid glass, it's right here. Thank you, Apple. Thank you for this timely release of releasing the iOS 26 UI kit. We don't want to find workarounds to create liquid glass effects. You should be doing that. And finally, it's there. Other things to highlight for you guys when it comes to this new library, which is a huge advancement to previous iOS libraries. Apple has leveraged Figma variables and not just styles. In order to see this, you can't see it if you're in your own file. But if you duplicate the iOS 26 UI kit to your files and you save it to your drafts, you'll be able to see how it is actually created. So with nothing selected, if I scroll to the very top, if you click on variables, Apple has created all these collections of variables. You've got app icon modes, you have colors, you have the kit itself, and you have variations of liquid glass. So this is definitely fantastic. I don't think they created variables yet for typography. Maybe this is coming later, but at least for the colors, all these are created. Like this, you can see there are so many components that you can leverage from the iOS UI kit. I can't wait to try all of this. There is even a color picker that you can leverage if your app requires one. This is a fantastic color picker. And of course, everything works with liquid glass backgrounds to match the liquid glass effect that was created by Apple. But none of that will be visible if you have it on a white background. You need to move it on top of a flexible background for you to be able to see things in a more exciting way. Thank you everyone for watching. I'll probably be doing more tutorials on the iOS 26 UI kit. We'll create more projects together for your portfolio. Super excited to share these updates with you.